Sojourner Truth Radio to Mali, what the mainstream media won't tell you about Africa. Our presenter is Dr. Gerald Horne, who holds the Morris Chair of History and African American Studies at the University of Houston. His research has addressed issues of racism in a variety of relations involving labor, politics, civil rights, international relations, and war. Dr. Horne is the author of about 32 books or so, and he's presently working on 5 new books. Among his latest are Fighting in Paradise, Labor Unions, Racism, and Communists in the Making of Modern Hawaii, and also Negro Comrades of the Crown, African Americans and the British Empire Fight the U.S. Before Emancipation. Let's give a warm KPFK community welcome to Dr. Gerald Horne.
Well, thank you very much for coming. Thank you to Sojourner Truth and KPFK for sponsoring this visit. Let me also add a few footnotes to that wonderful introduction by Margaret in order to sort of establish why I'm here talking about Africa. In 2001, I published this book on Zimbabwe. This is going to be awkward, I think I should. And some of you might have seen at the Pan-African Film Festival the wonderful film they showed on Zimbabwe, which I think is going to play again tomorrow.
6 o'clock.
Yeah.
9:15.
Oh. Yeah. Right. And then in 2009, actually I saw somebody walk in with this book. I published this book on Kenya here. Both, of course, former British colonies, both with long ties to the United States. And then in 2000, I published this book on Shirley Graham Du Bois, and which is part of a series of books on Shirley Graham Du Bois, W.E.B. Du Bois, W.E.B. Du Bois, you know, the father of Pan-Africanism. But having said that, let me say that it's going to be difficult to cover this entire continent of dozens of nations, history, past and present, in 40, 45 minutes. So I'm going to speak in broad strokes. Let me also say that, like the dog that didn't bark in the Sherlock Holmes story, what I'm not going to talk about is also important. And let me illustrate what I mean. I'm not going to be talking about Cameroon. And I mention that because the United States, from time to time, puts the spotlight on countries whose leaders don't seem to observe term limits, so to speak. And then they raise a hue and cry, which is the prelude to invasion. I recall that this was being done with regard to Zimbabwe in 2008. And I talked to this Pacifica host, not Margaret Prescod, of course, about her focus on Zimbabwe, which was so much in tune with what I was hearing in the mainstream. And I said,
that would not be mainstream.
Well, I said that. And so I said, why don't you talk about Cameroon, for example? Paul Biya's been in power for decades. I mean, he's a mass, gross human rights violator. Why don't you talk about Swaziland here, the last absolute monarchy on the African continent? I really recommend the documentary film you can find on Netflix, Without the King. Anybody see that, about Swaziland? I mean, it's a horror show in terms of misogyny, of male supremacy, oppression. But I sort of understand why even a Pacifica host might have difficulty focusing on these nations, because if you focus on Libya, you focus on Zimbabwe, you don't have to do as much introductory material, because the mainstream press has laid down a blanket, has laid down a barrage of propaganda, and so people feel familiar with it. Whereas if you talk about Swaziland or talk about Cameroon, well, then you have to do so much explaining as to why this is the focus, etc. So I'm not talking about those countries either. I'm not talking about Western Sahara. Ooh, what happened? Okay, I'm not talking about Western Sahara, the last colony on the African continent. I'm not talking about Madagascar. Here, some of you from Los Angeles might be familiar with Andy Rossoff, who was of Madagascar descent, ain't misbehaving, worked with Fats Waller, et cetera. As early as the 1690s, you had U.S. slave traders from New York who were grabbing Africans in Madagascar and taking them to North America. Oh, raise my voice? Okay. Sorry. Okay.
Yeah, because you're not talking in the mic.
Oh, okay. All right.
Yeah.
I'm not talking about Sudan, for example, which until quite recently was the largest country by territory on the African continent, but as you know, has suffered a split. Now, there are two nations occupying that soil, a split that, whatever its... Whatever the merits of that split might have been, it's undeniable that the United States and Israel had a lot to do with the split in Sudan, but I'm not going to be talking about that. But what I will be dealing with is a number of broad questions. And let me, in terms of my introductory remarks, lay down a number of themes. One is that the reason why Africa attracts so much attention is because of fragile political systems debilitated by colonialism combined with immense mineral wealth. I mean, for example, Nigeria, West Africa, oil, Angola, oil, Equatorial Guinea, oil, natural gas, which we're going to be spending some time talking about shortly, natural gas, Algeria, you recall the hostage crisis at the natural gas plant in Algeria just a few weeks ago. Natural gas, very important because it's going to tie into a number of our environmental concerns. Uranium in Niger, critical with regard to Mali, which is on the marquee of our discussion tonight. Diamonds in terms of...
Keep it on that level. I'm sorry, there's some people that are way in the back.
Okay, sure, no problem, no problem.
And clearly he's not paying attention to the mic. He's doing his professor thing. Remember to keep your voice raised.
Sure, absolutely. Diamonds, not only in terms of Namibia here, but also in terms of Zimbabwe as well. Gold in South Africa. So you have all of this immense mineral wealth and natural resources on a continent that has been debilitated and weakened by the slave trade and colonialism, which makes it a ripe target for the North Atlantic countries. Secondly, how can the North Atlantic countries, principally the United States of America, lay claim to these resources that obviously don't belong to them and get away with it? Well, for the longest time, part of the ideological rationale for this thievery was anti-communism. That is to say that those who were seeking to reclaim the wealth on behalf of the people were communists and therefore gross violators of human rights, therefore did not merit the high-minded claim of supposedly reclaiming the resources for the people. In the first place, perhaps this might lead to a discussion of Patrice Lumumba in the Congo, a nation that is larger than the United States east of the Mississippi River, however, having few bridges and highways, etc., not least because of the rapacious colonialism imposed on the Congo by the Belgians some decades ago. Patrice Lumumba, the first leader of independent Congo, you may know, was murdered with U.S. Central Intelligence Agency complicity in January 1961 in the transition from the Eisenhower to the Kennedy administration. Or take Nelson Mandela in South Africa. Nelson Mandela is seen as a secular saint today, someone who is admired across the ideological spectrum, but my gray hairs betray an age when I recall when Nelson Mandela was in prison, and not only was Dick Cheney applauding the fact that he was jailed, Dick Cheney, of course, being the former U.S. vice president, but also I'm afraid some organizations, civil rights organizations, who I will not name, were very...
We
Okay, all right, all right. Fair enough. See, this is a feisty crowd. No problem. Well, look, I used to live in New York, and I used to do a lot of anti-apartheid work in New York, and it was very difficult to get the NAACP to sign on to our marches because it was, because Washington had laid down this propaganda line that Nelson Mandela was a communist, and they were afraid to associate with communists, and so therefore they were afraid to associate with Nelson Mandela. Although I do recall, I was in Los Angeles in 1990 when Nelson Mandela came to the Coliseum, and it was filled, and a number of these people who had shunned him were now in the front row, but fair enough. That's the way it goes. Better late than never. Kwame Nkrumah of independent Ghana, coming to power in 1957 before being overthrown in 1966, you may recall, on a peace mission to Southeast Asia, overthrown once again, not only with the complicity of the US CIA, but recall that the US ambassador at the time in Accra, Ghana, was Franklin Williams, a black American, former NAACP leading official. Angola, coming to independence in 1975 from Portuguese colonialism. Perhaps unbeknownst to you, many of you in this room are of Angolan descent because there's a long relationship between the United States and Angola, particularly during the bad old days of the slave trade. And I recall when the still ruling party, MPLA, came to power, 1975, 1976, there was an attempt to destabilize the regime by Washington, funding Contra elements, as they were called. The Angolans thought that it would be a good idea to share the wealth. There's immense wealth in Angola, oil in particular. It's a major oil supplier to the United States. But basically, the United States and its allies says that you cannot build socialism. It's illegitimate. Okay, so fine. Now, perhaps the richest woman of African descent in the world, perhaps even richer than Oprah, is Isabel dos Santos, who is the daughter of the leader of the MPLA. In other words, the MPLA said, okay, fine, we can't build socialism, we'll build capitalism, and we'll make my daughter, the richest woman, African woman in the world. Same thing happened in Frelimo, Mozambique. Once again, in this nation in Southeast Africa, a number of African Americans were of Mozambican descent because in the latter stages of the slave trade, US slavers going into Mozambique, kidnapping people and dragging them across the Atlantic after coming to independence in the mid-1970s. They too were trying to redistribute the wealth from top to bottom, and Washington is LS say, no, you can't do that. So fine, there was a war that takes place that forces them away from their path. Are you signaling to me? Oh, okay. So, the major point that you need to keep in mind when we look at Africa today is to recognize that for decades that the United States and its allies had said that it's illegitimate to redistribute the wealth, it's illegitimate for you to reclaim your own resources because you're dirty thieving communists, and therefore you should not do this. Now, of course, you have to make certain kinds of distinctions. For example, the Catholic Church, bless its soul, is going through a leadership transition. And we all know the scandals about the Catholic Church, misogyny, child abuse, implicated in the slave trade, etc. But we also know that anti-Catholicism is an illegitimate ideology. And of course, it was once very prevalent in the United States of America. There used to be a political party called the Know Nothing Party in the 1850s. That's K-N-O-W, Know Nothing Party. That was a precursor to the Ku Klux Klan, but focused on Catholics, and was so organized and so sophisticated that it used to win elections on write-ins without running candidates. It would be, for example, in your primary in L.A. with Wendy Gruel and Jan Perry, Eric Garcetti, et cetera, that suddenly Dadon Kamathi wins on a write-in because his forces are so well organized that they troop to the polls and write in his name. That was the Know Nothing Party. It was a very strong party. So I say that to say that, we can discuss the merits and demerits of socialism, but that does not legitimate anti-communism as a philosophy, which has been used for very negative purposes. Now, I'm also going to be focusing on the United States of America, even though the major colonial powers on the African continent have been France, Britain, Portugal, etc. Now, Mitt Romney accused Barack Obama of doing an apology tour, apologizing for the United States. And I feel like I've been doing an apology tour, because when I begin to talk about the United States, it makes me rather sad about the roles that U.S. activists and U.S. scholars in particular have played in not helping to create a narrative that can explain the way forward and can shed light on how we got into so much difficulty. And for example, U.S. historians have not stressed sufficiently that when the United States was founded after the Declaration of Independence, July 4, 1776, that most Africans opposed it, because as they saw it, the purpose of establishing the United States was to circumvent slavery's abolition that was emanating from London, the then colonial power. They looked at the formation of the United States the way that Africans in Zimbabwe, then Rhodesia, looked at the white colonists in 1965 who tried to declare independence to circumvent decolonization. And as it turns out, they had a point, because after the formation of the United States of America, the slave trade skyrocketed. It reached a height that it had never reached before, mostly captained by U.S. nationals. One of the major reasons why you have more Africans living in Brazil than any country outside of Nigeria is because of U.S. nationals. I talk about this in my book, The Deepest South, the United States, Brazil, and the African Slave Trade. I have a book coming out hopefully next year called Exporting Slavery and Jim Crow, the United States and Cuba and the Road to Revolution, where I point out that one of the reasons you have so many Africans in Cuba is precisely because of U.S. nationals, even more so than Spanish nationals, and Spain being the colonial master. In fact, one of the few times when the United States prosecutes and indeed executes a slave trader takes place under the Lincoln administration in 1862, when a chap from Maine is smuggling hundreds of Congolese into Cuba and is detained by the U.S. authorities in the United States because it's in a death match with the so-called Confederate States of America, who had seceded on the basis of slavery, decide to prosecute him and execute him. So I should also mention that in Zanzibar, which is off the coast of Southeast Africa, part of Tanzania now, even before the Atlantic slave trade, it was a major locus of the slave trade heading east, which in some ways was larger than the Atlantic slave trade, and in some ways lasted longer. But by the 1850s, U.S. nationals were the major economic force in Zanzibar, which was like the Kmart of the slave trade. And so, in other words, you could get Africans of various varieties there. So, at this point, let me recall that in 1970, Willy Brandt, the then West German leader, he went to Warsaw, Poland. And he went up to a monument to mark the Warsaw Ghetto Uprising during World War II in the 1940s. And he was so overcome with grief at what the German people, or the German elite, had done to the Polish people, that he spontaneously fell on his knees and asked for forgiveness. So that's what I do right now on behalf of U.S. scholars. No, really, the U.S. left. On behalf of the U.S. left, U.S. scholars, Black scholars, Black radical scholars, I ask for your forgiveness, because we haven't done our job. We haven't provided a good explanation to explain how we got into this mess and how we're going to get out of this mess. And so let me apologize on behalf of all the groups that I purport to represent. Now, oh, I see. Oh, really? So this is a prelude to a few points, first of all, about Mali. Here, which as you know is in the headlines. Now, how do you explain that in recent days you had Africans in the streets of Mali who were cheering an intervention by French colonial forces who were seeking to drag the nation back to the 19th century? That is because, like many people, and people in the United States are well aware of this kind of difficult choice, sometimes life presents you with difficult choices. They were cheering these French because the option were these conservative religious radicals who wanted to drag them back to the 12th century. So they chose to opt for the 19th and not the 12th century, which actually is rational. But since media is one of our emphases here, I should mention that on Talk of the Nation, the NPR program just a few days ago, there was a program and they were just simply applauding the fact that there was this French intervention without stepping back and trying to understand how we got to this point where we had to make a decision between the 19th century versus the 12th century. And hopefully one of the things I'm going to try to do is to shed light on how we got to such a difficult position. Some of you may, of course, know about Kwame Nkrumah of Ghana and Patrice Lumumba of Congo and this wave of progressive African leaders, some of whom I've made reference to. Well, you should add to that pantheon Modibo Keita of Mali, who was overthrown with US, French, and NATO complicity in the 1960s, which basically helps to lay the groundwork for the rise of conservative religious radicalism. One of the major themes of world history that your grandchildren will be writing about, assuming that climate change does not overtake us all, is this trend of how the attack on the left forces, like Keita or like Nkrumah, basically prepares the battlefield and lays the groundwork for the rise of these various kinds of conservatism, or in Mali's case, this conservative religious radicalism. And matter of fact, you could say the same thing about the United States of America. Let me also say that in order to understand Africa, you also have to understand events outside of Africa. For example, in the last few decades of the 20th century, I'm going to underscore two pivotal developments that not only impacts Africa, but the whole world. One, Afghanistan, obviously in the news. Some of you may know that the crisis in Afghanistan actually began during the Jimmy Carter administration, 1978, after the coming to power of a left-wing party, the People's Democratic Party in Kabul. And the United States feels that it can ensnare the former Soviet Union in a Vietnam-style quagmire if it intervenes to support conservative religious radicals, which ultimately includes al-Qaeda and the so-called villainous Osama bin Laden. And this leads to a war that is continuing to this very day and, quite frankly, may be continuing indefinitely. Now, this turbocharging of conservative religious radicalism also has relevance for Africa, because as we will talk about shortly, if you look at the situation in Libya, which we'll talk about shortly, one of the things that happened was the overthrow of Muammar Gaddafi, who had been in power since August 1969, and had worked out an agreement with the United States to basically quarantine conservative religious radicalism, but the United States flipped the script on them, aligned with those radicals, overthrew Gaddafi, and now have installed them in power. In just a few days, of course, the predictable happened. The NATO countries said that their nationals all have to leave Benghazi because of threats on their lives, and we all know what happened to Ambassador Chris Stevens, the United States ambassador, slain by these radicals, which, interestingly enough, the Republicans are making a big to-do about in Congress, and for reasons that need not detain us here. So you had the rise, particularly in Africa, of this so-called Islamicist trend, which is growing, not least because the United States is sort of divided on what its approach should be. I mean, for example, they aligned with these forces in Libya. Supposedly, they're opposed to them in Mali. In Syria, they seem to be somewhat aligned with them. But it seems to me that this rather here nor there policy is basically going to lead to the further turbocharging of this conservative religious radical trend. The other trend that takes place is the rise of China. Now, before I talk about the rise of China, which also is going to have impact on Africa, let me draw an analogy. In the late 18th century, France was so obsessed, in a negative sense, with Great Britain, that it decided to support those who rebelled against British rule in 1776, led by George Washington. And it's fair to say that George Washington's campaign would not have succeeded but for French assistance. At the pivotal Battle of Yorktown that leads to the ultimate defeat of the Redcoats' British forces, a significant percentage of the troops are actually French troops. You even have Haitians brought over on French ships at the Battle of Savannah in the 1770s, including Henri Christophe, who goes on to be a leader of the Haitian Revolution. So France is essential to the establishment of the United States because of this obsession that Paris has with London. But France has to spend so much money helping these rebels and battling London that it leads directly to the French Revolution in 1789, then to the Haitian Revolution in 1791, et cetera. And these were unintended consequences, shall we say, that Paris did not contemplate. Similarly, in the latter part of the 20th century, the United States is so obsessed with Moscow that it turbocharges conservative religious radicalism in Afghanistan. Then, 40-odd years ago, U.S. President Richard Nixon goes to China, as you know. That's seen as a diplomatic masterstroke, Nixon to China. It's an opera about it that you might have seen. And basically aligns Beijing with Washington against Moscow. Now, this leads directly to the collapse of the Soviet Union. But it also, as part of the bargain, means massive foreign direct investment into China by U.S. corporations, which has now created this gargantuan power to the point where, as we mentioned on Sojourner Truth this past Friday, perhaps the most important words of President Barack Obama at his State of the Union address was his announcement that, even though it was only one sentence, that there's going to be negotiations for a free trade agreement with the European Union. In other words, sort of like NAFTA, Canada, Mexico, and the United States on steroids, but this time with the United States and the EU, 330 million people in the United States, 500 million people in the European Union. Sounds formidable, 830 million, but it still doesn't reach the 1.3 billion of China. And it's an acknowledge that this is all about China, and that the United States and EU, having created what they consider to be a Frankenstein monster, now realize that they need, that if they don't hang together, they'll hang separately, as was once said with regard to the rebels in North America. Now, this conservative religious radical trend, we talked about it in Mali, we could talk about it with regard to Somalia, where, as you know, there are United Nations forces, African Union forces, trying to subdue a so-called conservative radical trend, Al-Shabaab. We could talk about it even across the Red Sea in southern Yemen. You know about the drone strikes in Yemen, which is something perhaps we can talk about in terms of discussion. But what's oftentimes neglected by the U.S. press is that in the 1980s, you had a left-wing party ruling in southern Yemen, but was under ceaseless attack by the United States and its allies, finally chased out of power, and then once again, the predictable happens. You have the rise of these conservative religious radicals in Yemen, and now drone strikes are raining down to try to destroy what precisely the North Atlantic powers sought to create. And of course, Libya is exhibit A in this regard, with Abdelhakim Belhaj, who fought in Afghanistan, who then comes back to try to destabilize the Gaddafi regime, and then is assisted by the United States and its NATO allies, and now he is a leading figure in Libya, as Gaddafi lays in a grave somewhere. And yet, no satisfaction has been delivered because, as noted, you have the nationals of these North Atlantic countries now fleeing hither and yon from Libya precisely because they're under assault and under attack by the forces represented by Belhaj. Now, this brings us to the events of the past few years, which I'll be talking about intensively in the next few moments. We all know about what's been characterized as the Arab Spring and how it was set off in Tunis in North Africa, just across the Mediterranean from Italy, when a fruit vendor burns himself to death in protest against oppressive conditions in Tunisia. This leads to mass protests, which drives out the leader, Ben Ali, who now lives in Saudi Arabia. This has led to coming to power of a so-called soft Islamist party known as Ennahda. But you may have noticed the news of the past few days. That is to say, a leader of the secular forces, Shokri Belaid, was assassinated by so-called Islamist forces. And now there is a showdown in Tunisia between these two sides. Not only is it unclear who is going to prevail in this showdown, the conservative religious radicals or the secularists, it's also unclear to me, at least, who the United States will be supporting. Now, I'm sure some of you are saying to yourselves or thinking to yourselves, why should the United States support conservative religious radicals? Why don't they support the secularists? Well, since we're in Los Angeles, let me recall one of your favorite sons, Jack Benny. How many of you recall Jack Benny? Oh, good. Jack Benny was this comedian, and his favorite joke represents the dilemma of U.S. foreign policy. His joke was, oh, first of all, he had a reputation for being cheap. So his joke, his favorite joke was he's accosted by a robber. And the robber says, stick him up, your money or your life? And Jack Benny can't decide which one is more important. And that's the dilemma of U.S. foreign policy with regard to Africa. The conservative religious radicals may take your life, but the left forces will take, or may take, your property. And that's more important. So in a sense, you can almost see that as altruistic, as being far-sighted, sort of putting the system ahead of individual well-being. I mean, so, you know, there's a positive way to spend that. And so that's the dilemma for U.S. foreign policy. That's why they keep going back and forth, where, as I said, they seem to be opposing these forces in Mali, seem to be supporting them in Libya, unsure in Syria, because they can't decide which is more important, life itself or property. Although I can tell you that if history is any guide, it will be property. Now, which brings us to Egypt. The so-called Arab Spring, as you know, spread to Egypt by January 2011. By February 2011, the longtime leader, Hosni Mubarak, purported to be worth about $50 billion, had been driven from power along with his state of emergency that had been in existence for about 30 years, ever since he came to power when his predecessor, Anwar Sadat, was assassinated. You may have seen the video where Anwar Sadat is holding some sort of military parade, and suddenly These people jump from the crowd and start shooting everybody on the military platform. Hosni Mubarak ducks, which is very interesting. And he is not killed. And now, of course, because of elections, you have the Muslim Brotherhood in power. But once again, there seems to be a showdown between the Muslim Brotherhood forces and secular left forces, represented by a figure by the name of Hamdine Shabahi, who got about 20, 21, 22% in the election, which suggests that this is a formidable force to be reckoned with in Egypt. You should also know that Egypt has played a pivotal role in terms of the consciousness of black Americans going back to the 19th century. What is popularly referred as Afrocentrism, Afrocentrism could just as well be referred to as Egyptcentrism, given how Egypt plays this leading role in terms of the minds and consciousness of African Americans for decades. And that tendency took flight in the early 1950s when Gamal Abdel Nasser, a military figure, came to power and basically reached out to many black American figures, including Shirley Graham Du Bois, who after Nkrumah was overthrown, she was living in Ghana, moved to Cairo, and there were a number of black American exiles living in Cairo at that time. And of course, Nasser's Egypt stoked the ire of the North Atlantic powers, or at least France, Israel, and Britain, when they attacked his country in 1956 over his control of the Suez Canal, one of the major choke points in terms of international commerce. They were defeated, and interestingly enough, something to ponder is one of the reasons they were defeated is because the United States pulled the rug out from under France, Britain, and Israel, which leads to a turning point in world history, because basically France takes the conclusion, based upon its anger at the United States for bankrupting the country leading to the revolution in 17th, in the United States, establishing the United States, France takes the conclusion that it has to take an independent course, whereas Britain takes the opposite conclusion, that it has to stick close to the coattails of Washington. Anyway, after Nasser's overthrown, Anwar Sadat comes to power, Hosni Mubarak comes to power, etc. But once again, the theme that I'm leaving you with is that you have this showdown between left forces and various kinds of Islamist forces, and two things are unclear. One, who is going to prevail, and two, what's going to be the position of the United States with regard to this contestation. Now, this brings us to Libya. I'm sure you all know what happened in Libya. I'm sure you also know some of the backstory of Libya, that it's a major oil producer. In fact, Occidental Petroleum of Los Angeles, a stone's throw from where we're sitting now, has been a major force in the Libyan oil industry going back decades. And of course, I'm sure they were dancing in the streets on Westwood after Gaddafi was slain and laid to rest. After Gaddafi comes to power in 1969, of course, he basically shuts down one of the major US air bases, Willis Air Force Base in Libya, which does not win him plaudits in Washington. But you also may know that the Marine hymn, From the Halls of Montezuma to the Shores of Tripoli, speaks to a time when there was sharp fighting between the forces in what is now Benghazi and U.S. forces. As a matter of fact, there's been a lot of writing about in the early 19th century how these North Africans were basically kidnapping, in some cases enslaving, Euro-American sailors and then asking for ransom money in order for them to be released, which leads to sharp clashes between the North Africans and the United States. But what really, it seems to me, stokes the ire of Washington with regard to Libya is the fact that the Gaddafi regime makes overtures to black Americans. He makes multi-million dollar loans, you may recall, to certain unnamed black American organizations. And in any case, sparked by Tunisia and Egypt, protests erupt in Libya. You recall the press coverage at the time. There's going to be a massacre of civilians in Benghazi unless Washington acts. The press tells us that there was a split in Washington. on the one hand, you had a hawkish response by Secretary of State Clinton, UN Ambassador Susan Rice, and State Department aide Samantha Power. And supposedly, according to press reports, you had Pentagon Chief Bob Gates and US President Obama on the other side of the fence. The former prevails. The United States rushes to the United Nations Security Council, supposedly to get a no-fly zone to protect civilians. But the no-fly zone quickly morphs into regime change. And by the fall of 2011, Gaddafi is overthrown. A couple of points that I should raise in this regard. One point, those of you who are listeners to Pacifica may want to ask yourselves, since we're talking about the press and not just the mainstream press, is... Well, no, I mean, you know, it's a matter of public record. It's all over the internet. Why were some of our friends at Pacifica so gung-ho about this NATO war and this NATO intervention? It's... Well, no. But this also, and here's a political point. We mentioned at the top Zimbabwe. And some of you may recall that in 2008, there was a similar hue and cry about Zimbabwe. Longtime leader who doesn't respect term limits, human rights violations, debate at the United Nations Security Council that presumably would lead to intervention. But unlike Libya, the Russians and the Chinese veto the United Nations Security Council resolution, and therefore there's no intervention. Now, you may want to ask yourselves why the difference. Well, one of the differences is that the Southern Africans in particular were united against external military intervention by the North Atlantic countries, whereas the Arab League, particularly Saudi Arabia, said, have a go at him, basically. Although it should be mentioned in this context, since it's relevant, is that the Algerians opposed the war against Libya. And in fact, the Algerians are now housing a number of leading members of the Gaddafi family. I should also mention that I'm going to talk for a few seconds about Southern Africa, but I should mention in this context that the mediation efforts of then South African President Thabo Mbeki played a leading role in forestalling a military intervention. And this did not win him applause in the North Atlantic countries. And I'm no opponent of the South African regime, but I have to say I think it was a mistake when shortly after he had negotiated this agreement leading to a resolution, a political solution in Zimbabwe, there was an internal palace coup, and he was dislodged from office and no longer serves as president of South Africa. Now, the Libyan intervention leads directly to the crisis in Mali. From Mali to Congo, as you know, is the name of our forum. In a number of ways. Number one, in order to dislodge Gaddafi, crates, tons of weapons were dropped in northern Africa. And if crates, tons of weapons are dropped in Tijuana, I think that it would probably have repercussions across the border. Well, this is what happened in this very fragile region, that is to say, fragile politically. But not only that, you have a minority group, the Tuaregs, in Mali, who were close to Gaddafi. After he's overthrown, they return to Mali. I should say parenthetically that there is a story waiting to be told by a budding young historian about what happens to the dark-skinned people in Libya after Gaddafi is overthrown, the reign of terror that's unleashed against them, which makes all the more curious the response of some of our Pacifica friends, because you would think in a country like the United States, where persecution of dark-skinned people has been part of the cultural and political DNA, that there would be sensitivity to this kind of question, but apparently the sensitivity was lacking. So the Tuaregs flee back home. They lead an uprising against the government, the central government in Bamako in the south. And by the way, 70% of the people of Mali live in the South. The North is, as has often been said, larger than France. But after the Tuareg rebellion pushes out the central regime, the conservative religious radicals push out the Tuaregs. And then, at the same time in 2012, there's a coup, a military coup against the civilian government. The military in Mali says they didn't like the way the government was supporting or not supporting them in their fight against the separatists. I should add that these military figures were trained by the United States government. And interestingly enough, after the coup takes place, many of these U.S. trained soldiers defect to the other side with weaponry, sophisticated weaponry. So after these conservative religious radicals come to power, they unleash predictably a reign of terror. Single women are persecuted because supposedly single women with children are threatening the moral and social fabric of the country. Thieves have their limbs amputated on accusations of stealing. Shrines are defaced that supposedly do not conform to their vision of Islam. And sadly and tragically enough, these manuscripts in Timbuktu, which go back hundreds of years to a time when Timbuktu was a center of learning, particularly in astronomy, particularly in science, particularly in terms of artistic creativity, these manuscripts come under threat. Apparently, only a small percentage of these manuscripts are destroyed. In any case, this leads to the question that I opened with, which is that you then have this French intervention to topple these radicals, and the people of Mali are left with this very unpalatable choice between the 12th century and the 19th century, and understandably, they choose the 12th century, at least many of them. But once again, sorry about that. So what are the regional implications? Well, one, Niger, you might have seen the movie Fair Game with Sean Penn that talks about Ambassador Joseph Wilson during the crisis in Iraq. And there's this allegation that Saddam Hussein is making nuclear weapons and the yellow cake is coming from Niger. Well, uranium is a major export of Niger. It's Mali's neighbor to the east. One of the reasons why France supposedly intervened was because it was afraid of what was going to happen to its uranium supply, which is pivotal in terms of the generation of electricity in France itself. Secondly, the United States, which already has a drone base in Djibouti in the eastern part of Africa near Ethiopia, now is opening a drone base in Niger. The United States is also supporting the French intervention with intelligence, surveillance, and reconnaissance, also transporting troops. So the United States is sinking into this quagmire in Northwest Africa along with France. In Nigeria, the continent's giant, the most populous country on the African continent, which is also a major oil supplier to the United States, you have these conservative religious radicals known as the Boko Haram, who specialize in blowing up churches and attacking worshipers. They had established military camps in Mali, and the bottom line is that a quagmire is unfolding in this part of Africa that will be soaking up your tax dollars and the lives of many Africans, because not only will civilians be sacrificed during this war, but under the rubric, under the slogan of African solutions to African problems, you're going to have African troops from Nigeria and from the economic community of West African states who are now intervening in Mali to fight these radicals. One of the key countries is Algeria. You know about the hostage crisis that took place here? You know about their opposition to the Libyan war and their support for Gaddafi's family? Like Gaddafi himself, they also extended and embraced the Black Americans, the Black Panther Party, in the 1960s. His major diplomatic mission abroad was in Algeria. This is something that Washington is reluctant to forget. But I should also mention natural gas. And let me just step back for a second. Our friends in the environmental movement are doing a marvelous job in terms of putting the spotlight on oil and coal and dirty energy in particular, and its connection to greenhouse gases that are presumably warming up the planet, leading to climate change, and even possibly some of the strange weather that the world and this country have been enduring, and underline possibly. So what's happening, and I should also mention that on college campuses, just like college students some years ago demanded that college endowments not invest in corporations that have holdings in apartheid South Africa, now they're doing the same thing with regard to oil, for example. Divest your endowment from oil. This is having impact. So what's happening? There is a movement towards natural gas, which is billed as being an alternative to oil. The problem is that Algeria is a major producer of natural gas, and Russia is too. And they've been engaged in an alliance to try, from Washington's point of view, to get a stranglehold over natural gas. Now, there's an article in the New York Times today talking about New England and how New England is heavily dependent not only on natural gas for heating, but also natural gas in terms of the generation of electricity. So there's increasing worry that just like Western Europe feels that it is held hostage by Russia because Russia supplies natural gas to Western Europe, making sure that Europeans do not freeze in the dark. There is a fear that Algeria and Russia will have the same impact, for example, on New England. I should also mention in that context for you Laker fans that the Oklahoma City Thunder, who has been thrashing the Lakers, as you know, repeatedly, the major investor in that team, and as a matter of fact, you may know, they play in Chesapeake Energy Arena. Chesapeake Energy, of course, is a major producer of natural gas. So you may want to follow Kevin Durant as we talk about this. So in any case, when this hostage crisis erupted at the natural gas plant in Algeria, the Algerians were very suspicious because they know that even though supposedly, the United States didn't like these conservative religious radicals who took hostage these Europeans and Japanese. But they were very suspicious. They're also suspicious because it's well known that the conservative religious radicals are backed by the Saudis, they're backed by the Qataris. The Qataris, as you know, support Al Jazeera, television and radio. And they also know that the leader of these forces, Bel Mukhtar, fought alongside the United States in Afghanistan, and he's known as the Marlboro Man because supposedly he's involved in cigarette smuggling, although there might be a more devious explanation for his nickname. And not only that, but the hostage crisis took place close to the Libyan border. It was basically plotted in Libya, and so the Algerians are very suspicious going forward, and they're very reluctant to cooperate with the French and the United States in Mali, which is on Algeria's southern border, as you see, because they're worried about the machinations of the United States and France, as well they should be. But what that guarantees, of course, is that this crisis will be continuing. How much time do I have, Margaret?
2 hours.
Oh, yes, Congo. Now, I mentioned Congo in my introductory remarks at the heart of Africa. And once again, to reiterate, the relations with the United States and the Congo extend to the bad old days of the slave trade. Some of us in this room are probably of Congolese origin or Congolese descent because it was really a happy hunting ground for slave traders. Some of you may be familiar with the misrule of the Belgians beginning in the late 19th century. King Leopold basically had it, not necessarily as a Belgian colony, but as his personal fiefdom. I mentioned that Swazi film, Without the King, which I recommend. You can find it on Netflix. There's a film about Congo, White King, Red Rubber, Black Death. Yeah, it's very interesting in terms of that. And you should also know that in terms of Congo's vast resources, to cite one example amongst many, that the nuclear weapon that incinerated tens of thousands in Hiroshima and Nagasaki in August 1945, the uranium basically came from the Congo under Belgian rule. Things were supposedly on the fast track to change when Patrice Lumumba comes to power in 1960, but as you know, he was assassinated in 1961 because he was seen as pro-communist and a comrade of Kwame Nkrumah and Modibo Keita and Ben Bella of Algeria, Sékou Touré of Guinea. And this leads to the coming to power of the man once known as Joseph Mobutu, a low-ranking soldier, changed his name to Mobutu Sese Seko, becomes probably wealthier than Hosni Mubarak, who had a fortune of $50 billion. And if there is one little factoid that I can cite to you as an example of the decadence that he helped to bring to Congo, is the fact that his mistress was the identical twin of his wife. There's a documentary film. Does anybody know that documentary film about, it's called Mobutu, King of Africa, something like that, that shows them on the platform together. It's very creepy. But because of the misrule of Mobutu, this leads to frequent uprisings. You may know that Che Guevara himself, along with Victor Drake of Cuba, go to Congo. There's a diary that Che keeps that you can find in any library or many progressive bookstores, but they basically come up empty. You also know that a rebellion breaks out in the 1970s, almost leading to the overthrow of Mobutu, but is squashed by Jimmy Carter and the Moroccans, which basically extends the lease on life of Mobutu. Finally, he passes away and is overthrown simultaneously in the 1990s. And this leads to a further crisis, leading to the coming to power of Laurent Kabila, who in part is assisted by Rwandan forces. That is to say, I should say, Congolese forces of Rwandan origin, and there hangs a tale, which we'll get to shortly. After Kabila comes to power, he tries to work out a deal with the Chinese, and I haven't talked enough about China, hopefully in discussion we can get to that, that in return for the vast resources of Congo, the Chinese authorities are going to build roads and hospitals and universities and bridges and airports and all the rest. But the North Atlantic countries object. Some say they object for good reasons. Others say they object for spiteful reasons. But in any case, the deal does not go through. And as a result of this dearth of economic assistance, Congo spirals further into crisis after Laurent Kabila passes away. He's succeeded by his son, Joseph Kabila. One of the major problems in Congo, however, is despite the fact that they have an army of 150,000, many of the army are not paid regularly. Now, you can imagine what would happen if the LAPD and the California Highway Patrol were not paid regularly, yet they're carrying guns and seem to have a predisposition towards mayhem. It would lead to a crisis, and that's precisely what's happening in the Congo. The crisis is exacerbated by the fact that, as you know, in April 1994, there was this major genocide in neighboring Rwanda on the border with Eastern Congo. And as you know, in a matter of weeks, in a spectacularly murderous fashion, tens of thousands, perhaps 800,000 people are slaughtered en masse. You might have seen the Hollywood film Hotel Rwanda, starring Don Cheadle, which goes into this. I bring that up for a number of reasons. One, the Rwandan regime under Paul Kagame, who was trained militarily in the United States, have been charged with seeking to destabilize Congo and backing forces that are trying to overthrow Joseph Kabila. On the other hand, Rwanda, in some ways, it reminds me of Israel. That is to say that because of this guilt that many have felt, understandably, about the Holocaust, it leads to the overlooking of many of the present-day transgressions of the Israeli regime. And I think there's something similar with regard to Rwanda, because of guilt concerning what particularly the United States and other North Atlantic countries did not do during the genocide. This leads to giving Paul Kagame a pass, but the fact of the matter is, as many investigations, not least by the United States, have shown, Paul Kagame's forces are wreaking havoc in Congo, and I think you're going to show a short...
Actually, we're not, because we want to have some more time.
Okay, no problem. So, there's more I could say. Let me make just one more point.
Please.
And this may be the most important point. What is our role? In past years and past decades, there have been organizations like the Council on African Affairs, started by Paul Robeson in 1937, that spearheaded the struggle against apartheid, against colonialism. In recent decades, you had Trans-Africa and the Free South Africa movement. You had a mass movement on campuses pushing for divestment, which was a marvelous example of student mobilizing and student organizing. I would say in conclusion that now more than ever, we need that kind of energy, we need that kind of militancy, we need that kind of organizing, not only because we're talking about a continent that has suffered, as we have noted in recent minutes, at the hands of the United States authorities, but also, as the quagmire in Mali tends to suggest, there is a proliferating war that's developing, featuring the promiscuous use of drone warfare, involving the US government, involving your tax dollars, that could be going to alleviate this traffic crisis you see in the City of Angels by building more mass transit, or going to this decrepit healthcare system that afflicts us all, are going to alleviate the housing crisis, but instead it's going to wars in Northwest Africa, wars that are erupting in no small part because of previous misdeeds and blunders by the United States itself. It's almost as if there's this scheme to create one crisis after another in a sort of strategy of chaos, and then continually pumping money into the military to deal with the chaos that they've helped to create. I mean, it sounds like bad science fiction, but actually it's a bad reality. Thank you very much.
Dr. Horne, first of all, I would like to thank you for coming out. And as an African-American, African descent person, and a leftist person, all my life, I want to thank you for being my mentor, my guide, my teacher. I mean, you've meant a lot to me in my life. My question is, what is your assessment of the role of the Communist Party of China and China itself in its dealings with Africa? Is it a positive thing for African people? Is it a negative thing? Or it's more dialectical, you know.
Oh, okay.
We're going to take a few questions and then let Dr. Horne respond. So get your notes down, Dr. Horne. Okay, thank you.
Thank you for the lecture, Dr. Horne. I wanted you to talk about some of the martyrs. This is African Liberation Month or Black History Month. You mentioned the Cameroon, and Cameroon was crushed. They had a very powerful movement in Cameroon, but we don't know about people like Felix Mumi because they were destroyed. They were a secular force, and unlike Sekou Touré and Kwame Nkrumah, we don't know about them. So could you talk about Cameroon, the role that they played, and specifically talk about who Felix Mumi was and the fact that they wiped out, I think, two or three central committees of the party in Cameroon.
Thank you. Bella,
step up. I want to make sure you get your questions written down. Excellent. I thank you very much. I get here a little late, but and I'm glad to see the full capacity and beyond, because you deserve that and more. So I agree with you, Margaret. I want you to please, I have asked you this before, so this is not new to you. You ran under the Peace and Freedom Party before. I want you to spell out the difference between the fake left in the United... Do not laugh. This is no laughing matter for me, so be respectful now, because I honor you. Thank you. So the fake left in the United States and the true historic global left, global. So you know what I'm talking about. Thank you.
Dr. Horne, thank you for allowing me to repeat my question to you personally. How do we get or clone you? In terms of your penchants for scholarship, how do we get our children from preschool or early elementary school, how do we give them the culture of study that produces the level of consciousness that you have?
Dr. Horne, thank you so much for illuminating these topics, and I thank you too, Margaret, for bringing him to my awareness, and I have benefited a lot, because I have no other source for this information that you're providing in a lot of instances. But I had just learned very recently that acreage the size of twice the state of Nevada is being bought up. They're buying the water rights, they're buying the soil, there's a plan for exportation, like plantation style, not to meet the local needs, and it will displace a lot of the people there. It's in various countries throughout Africa. It was Bill Gates' foundation. They want to use genetically modified crops. Yes. And it's Ted Turner buying up, and it's USA investors, Israel, and China buying up huge amounts. And I'd like to know what recourse does anybody here have on that action? Thank you.
Excellent. Dr. Horne has requested a pause in these five. There have been five questions. Okay. He will address these, and then we'll go to another set. Is that okay?
Yes. Yeah.
We got time, y'all. I know it's a little hot in here, but we can stand a little heat.
Can I speak to this? Oh, good. Well, these are very excellent, and I should also say difficult questions. Very difficult questions. I mean, for example, take the last question. This question that has been posed is part of a larger, profound agricultural question. Some of you may be familiar with the horse meat crisis now unfolding in Europe. And I dare say that it has probably crossed the Atlantic, unbeknownst to us, which is an existential question, because that means we cannot be sure about what we're putting in our mouths. And you might have heard the latest news, which is some sort of painkiller that had been given to horses has now entered the food chain and now is a inflicting us all. Now, when I shouldn't say inflicting us all, it's inflicting whoever's eating horse meat, which is probably not most of you. I should also mention a footnote, too, because this is a particular interest of mine. Part of the horse meat crisis is part of the financial crisis. That is to say that in Ireland in particular, when things seem to be booming, many people were buying horses for their children and, you know, as birthday presents, etc. Then the economy collapsed, and they didn't know what to do with the horses. So
They began selling them to abattoirs, and then people being enterprising in capitalist societies, they began selling this horse meat masqueraded as beef. And then after that took off, other people decided that this was a marvelous idea to sell horse meat as beef. The territorial crisis that was mentioned is also part of this crisis, because as the questioner posed, in Africa in particular, given the fragility of the political system, there are thousands of acres and hectares of land that are being bought up. The South Koreans have been active in this regard. The Saudis have been active in this regard. And as noted, it's unclear, shall we say, if the food that's going to be grown is somehow going to get to the local people in Africa itself. And unclear is a euphemism. So the question, as ever, is what is to be done given this crisis? And I'm afraid that I can only tell you what you already know, which is that, number one, there are a number of political organizations in the United States in the environmental and agricultural movement that are organizing against this sort of thing. They're dwarfed, that is to say, the groups in the United States are dwarfed in size by groups in Europe and in Asia that are, and in Africa itself, that are organizing against this sort of thing. And all I can ask is that we plug into these groups and try to help them. Now, with regard to the question about, this is also very difficult, you know, our youth, and how do we encourage scholarship amongst our youth, and which is a very difficult question given this, shall we say, slowdown in the U.S. economy, which bids fair not to be ending anytime soon, given the strength of conservatism and the right wing in Washington in particular. But I would only say that we obviously need more emphasis on our public school system. We obviously need more organizing to beat back this charter school movement and voucher movement. We obviously need efforts to strengthen the teachers' union, the National Education Association, the American Federation of Teachers. I was happy to see that some of the nurses' organizations are now aligning with the teachers, which is going to strengthen both. And it's those sorts of movements, it seems to me, that are ultimately going to be the salvation for our youth, because it's going to be very difficult in crowded classrooms to expect meritorious performance when not only are the classrooms crowded, but then there's not sufficient equipment, and there's these disparities between certain school districts that have tax revenue and other school districts that don't, et cetera. But it seems to me it starts with the unions. It starts with the National Education Association, the American Federation of Teachers. Now, with regard to my friend's comment about the fake left and what is referred to as the fake left and what was referred to as the true historic left, well, you know, it's a difficult thing. I mean, just personally, you know, my whole personal MO has been, even though I made some pointed comments about.
You know, we have two-party dictatorship in the U.S.
Wait, Bella, his turn.
You know, even though I made these pointed comments about Pacifica, but that's because you know, press was in the title of this discussion, and is this Pacifica, et cetera. But on a personal level, I have to confess, my personal bent is to try to avoid. I try commenting on other left forces.
You mean you don't know what the fake left is?
Yeah. I mean, but I mean, if we were to have a private discussion.
Why not in public?
Excuse me, Bella. This is not a debate between you and Dr. Horne about the left. This is a teaching on African American
Studies. Please. Wait. Well. Well, I mean, your point is well taken, and yes, absolutely. My argument is certainly not with you. My brother mentioned the question of Cameroon, which, as I started off, as you may recall, talking in the beginning about countries we would not talk about for various reasons, and one of whom was Cameroon, where the leader, Paul Biya, has been in power for more years than some of you have been on this planet, and does not seem to be slowing down at all. And yet, the question we should be asking ourselves is, well, why isn't Paul Biya in the New York Times on a daily basis being thrashed like other African leaders have been thrashed? Why is it that there are a parade of African leaders in the International Criminal Court at The Hague? If you didn't know any better, you would think that the International Criminal Court should be called the African International Criminal Court, because they only seem to indict African leaders, with the exception of Yugoslavia, for example. And this is even more tragic because, as the import of the question suggested, you know, there has been a human rights catastrophe unfolding in Cameroon, a country, by the way. If I were to make one footnote, I know the brother who asked the question is from Canada, and I've always thought that Canadians should have a particular interest in Cameroon, because just like Canada has this Anglophone, Francophone split, that is to say, was partially colonized by the French, partially colonized by the British, and so therefore people tend to be either French-speaking or English-speaking or both. That's the same in Cameroon, and I've oftentimes thought that the Canadians should take a particular interest in Cameroon. Cameroon is also strategic because of its proximity not only to Nigeria, a major oil producer, but also to Chad, which has a pipeline going into Cameroon with the oil shipped out through Cameroon ports to the North Atlantic countries, et cetera. The brother also mentioned Félix Moumier, who was an example of a leader like Modibo Keita and Kwame Nkrumah, who was basically squashed because he was such a progressive force.